This is the SF Productions Podcast Network.
Good evening and welcome to another exciting episode of Vast Wasteland.
Bubblegum, 10-cent candy bars, 15-cent hamburgers,
when a dollar went a long way, and so did 24 hours. The 60s and the 70s, dwelling place of the lost generation. We who grew up in this era had no real heroes. Our role models came from the imaginations of others. Our meager lives were formed by and revolved around weekly installments of our favorite TV programs.
Welcome to a place that your parents didn't understand. A place that exists somewhere between the forefront of recollectable memory and the edge of everyday thought. Welcome to the vast wasteland. Welcome home.
Good evening and welcome to another exciting episode of Vast Wasteland. Yes, it's the show where we talk about 60s and 70s television. And today, we're in outer space! Yes, we're going to talk about science fiction and not Star Trek, basically. We already have done our big Star Trek show, so we're doing all science fiction in the 60s and 70s on television. Other than Star Trek. But we've got just loads of stuff to hit for tonight, so let's just... Wilbert can stop playing with his little Terminator things, let's zip over to Wilbert with his first point for the evening.
Ooh, that was just a bunch of TV, a bunch of science fiction TV in the 60s and the 70s. My goodness, there were so many shows, we can't name them all.
Go ahead.
Oh, my. Of course, well, Star Trek was probably the biggest, but hey, before that, we had shows like Lost in Space, and ooh, there was...
My favorite Martian,
yep. But we're probably going to cover him in another one, actually, even though that is science fiction. That's good science fiction, too. We'll cover My Favorite Martian in another show.
And why are we all doggy leg DJs? Not really good.
And, well, let's see now, okay, now Lost in Space was probably the other big one from the 60s. I mean, big as far as having a family. And, ooh, we're going to have this family, and they're going to Alpha Centauri. That was their
Centauri. Being done in the 60s.
Oh, yes, everybody wanted to go to Alpha Centauri. It was just the favorite place to go. But when they got up there, oh, by golly, what happened? An asteroid shower or something?
No, Dr. Smith threw him off balance with his extra... Okay, he was a stowaway.
Yeah,
the ship was not built to accommodate stowaways.
Well,
I mean,
no ships
are. If they were going to bring anything back with them, they couldn't because the ship wasn't built to take extra weight.
Mm-hmm.
So Dr. Smith actually threw him off course. It was his fault, as was everything that happened.
Right.
Okay. His fault.
Because
he thought... Now, was Robot supposed to go with them?
Yeah.
Okay, Robot...
Yeah, that was an essential part of the whole thing.
But Dr. Smith had built Robot.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Robot, what a name.
Robot.
What a
Come
robot.
Over here,
danger,
robot.
Danger! Warning!
Warning!
Danger!
Warning! Well, Robin's a warning, danger.
No, the thing to do, the dude robot, you put arm in your sleeve,
and
you put out two fingers like that, and you,
Danger, Will Robinson. Warning, warning. Danger, danger.
That's another one of those shows where, well, not so much that one, but shows that were based back on Earth. Well, this one was, well, the robot had the voice that was used for every alien that was ever on Lost, Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea,
mm-hmm.
which was another one of those big science fiction shows from the 60s, Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea, although that one was Earth-based more than being out in space. It was still considered science fiction because you have your nuclear-powered submarine here, although I guess you got a nuclear-powered submarine that had,
We could probably even show that nuclear-powered submarine.
It's the Sea View was the big ship on there.
We have some visual aids down here, though. Any day now, they'll get around to getting those. But, so go on.
You'll see them somewhere before the show's over.
Right,
and
we'll see them.
They had the flying sub, which was an amazing little thing. It was a two-person sub, yet it's probably bigger than any family car. And it's bigger than probably most two-person airplanes. But anyway, it had the capability of flying above the water. It could fly, and it could also go underwater as a submarine, and it was just an amazing thing there. Of course, Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea was one of the many Irwin Allen science fiction TV
Irwin
shows.
Irwin Allen really irks me with he has no proportion in his mind. Land of the Giants. Today we're going to use the telephone. We're going to use a pencil to dial the phone, but it's like
then later,
another shot, they're
like,
sitting on the phone, and
yeah.
And they're bigger than it is.
Mm-hmm.
And Jupiter 2, the thing that always got me about the Jupiter 2, when you saw it in space, it looked, but when it landed, it always seemed like it must have landed in a hole in the ground.
Right.
Because it was like a one-story, they walked right out of it onto the ground.
Right.
And so I was like, what, did it always land in a crater? Did it dig a little hole and then land?
And you knew there were several stories because they kept using those tubes and going up
and
down.
They had the elevator.
I was like, if they went inside, they must be going down underground.
We figure.
Because,
it was like
but then when it was
the
out
ground.
Into the space, like you can see, it's like
what's the
it
deal?
It looks big.
Yeah.
So I think Irwin Allen needed to take some art classes.
Well, that's the thing about the 60s. The 60s were the time where you could just suspend disbelief or hope we hope that you could.
They hoped we could.
Which was why when Star Trek did come out, it was a lot of people really liked it because it did stay pretty much with the same parameters. They didn't jump from one size to another or something like that, or the things weren't all mixed up. But we've discussed that one, so we're going to talk about these that are just, I guess you consider them bad TV. Now, the Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea thing, basically, I don't think they actually had a definite mission. They were just underwater all the time. It's a submarine, so of course they're underwater. Only time they seemed to come up above the water was when they were in the Arctic or the Antarctic, which didn't make sense to me.
Right. this would not be the place to come up with a submarine.
And
but
yet, that's the only place where you saw them break the surface so they could come up through all these ice floes and everything and be up there for a while. Why? I don't know. Maybe there were some people that were up there discovering things and they'd gotten stranded or something, so they had to come up. But anyway, the flying sub, usually, whenever they had to make their trips any place else, they would use that and they'd fly to Washington or fly wherever else they had to go.
We gotta fly out here and get some money to run this ship. We gotta fly out here and get some food.
And you had your characters. So you have Admiral Nelson, Captain Crane, Sharky. Sharky was always down there. What did Sharky do? I don't even remember what Sharky did. And then there was
one I didn't watch
somebody that. Else that was like a lieutenant or somebody that was always on. And then Kowalski was always there. Kowalski was like the Chekhov of the
right,
show.
Yeah.
Kowalski always got hurt, but yet Kowalski was always back around and come back again. And Sharky, I guess Sharky must have been the engineer. That just makes sense to me.
I think so.
And
the Irwin Allens were the ones where we take this group of people, unrelated, and we throw them into a situation where they've got, well, I guess the Robinson family was related, except
for Dr. Smith.
Yeah.
And, of course, then Don had the Robinsons' beautiful tall daughter, Judy, chasing after him all the time. So,
the
trip was fine.
What a deal. Yeah.
And then, of course, there was Land of the Giants, where nobody was really, their poor little orphan kid and his little dog and the rest of the dumb people on there.
Mr. Fitzhugh, that was Fitzhugh.
Who was
Fitzhugh? Was he like a
he was sort of the Dr. Smith of the group because he was the the real negative kind of person.
But I'm just trying to figure, what was his real thing there? He had all this money in that first show where he was trying to get away from somewhere, and then he got out there and he lost it all. What? They never really explained exactly what he had done.
Land of the Giants used to scare me, and I didn't watch it for a long time when I was little because they would come on and say, Land of the Giants, and that was enough to scare me right there. Oh, this is scary! So I would, go hide in my room until it was, safe to come out.
Land of the Giants! Scary TV! Ooh.
Well, when you're, 5 years old, everything's the Land of the Giants anyway.
So that's Land of the Giants, another one of the great Irwin Allen. But it's basically the Spindrift, which was the little ship they were on. It's like, I guess there must have been bigger ships, because this one was only a six-person craft, and not counting the pilot, the co-pilot, and the stewardess. So
yeah,
it was like
dog.
Well, the dog was in that Toto basket. You know, it didn't see the dog until he jumped out of the basket. But
right. Anyway,
you got a movie star here on here that's like Ginger from Gilligan's Island.
Yeah, there's a lot of similarities.
You got the
Gilligan's Island, Land of the Giants.
You got the little kid and his dog.
Yeah.
People trapped somewhere and they can't leave. And
you got the little kid and the dog, which is, you might as well say it's Dorothy and Toto,
right. Basically.
And then you got Fitzhugh, who's like the Dr. Smith of the show. And then you got the pilot, the co-pilot, and you got the stewardess. And what happens? They're flying from where? New York to London or something.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like the space shuttle, what they're planning to do with the space shuttle, I guess, eventually, where it can fly from, well, not the space shuttle so much, the SST, I suppose.
Right.
Except this one could go out of the atmosphere.
It just
space.
Go up and wait till the Earth orbited around and come back down.
Okay.
Yeah.
It should have, yeah.
On all these shows, they're going into space, they're going somewhere else. Why did everyone speak English? Why did they run into aliens from wherever? And it's like, hi, Mr. Allen. Hello, Will Robinson.
Yeah.
And why couldn't they figure out on Land of the Giants? Everything was just like home.
Yeah.
Well, they did actually say on one show that it wasn't Earth, and so they believed him. The guy could have been lying for all they know.
No, this isn't Earth. No.
No way.
But they go out into space. They fly through the green cloud, the mysterious green cloud. And they fly through that thing, and oh no, it sets all the instruments. Oh no, they're going crazy.
No.
And they come back down. They're supposed to be in London, but yet they don't know where they are because they can't get any signals. They can't get anything. And then they land, and they're looking around. They're trying to find something. They think the airport. They don't know if they're at the airport or not.
They just didn't know where they were.
And they get out, and they go wandering. And there's fog everywhere, so it must be London. And yet the first thing that they finally do see is like a giant cat. And it's
a lot of cats.
And there were
and
giant.
The guy had to bark at him.
Oh, yeah.
There's this cat.
I wouldn't be barking if I were you.
It's like at that time they're only about this big. Yet later in the show, they're probably this tall.
Yeah.
And I can pick up the pencil and dial the phone.
Right.
They capture him and capture him with forceps and put him into a mouse cage.
Yeah.
Oh, what a great show! They just had trouble. It was this whole perspective, I guess, was off, and so. But Irwin Allen went on to do other. He went on. He got off of TV after those, and he went and did movies.
Well, I mean, he was quoted. He said, I won't get this quote exactly correctly, but it says that he said a movie was a show was worthless if you couldn't blow up the world in the first 10 minutes.
Okay.
I mean, to him, it was like effects was everything, and plot and continuity and characterization was like, well, if we get around to those, we'll do them. But the big thing is, we want the effect.
So I guess that's basically what he was trying to do with the Robinsons. It's like they're on a mission. Oh, but their mission gets blown up, so they're off in space somewhere.
Right.
Land of the Giants, they've got to go somewhere. Oh, but they can't get there because they go through that darn green cloud. And so their whole world gets blown up, and they're someplace else. Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea, it's like a nuclear submarine. It's, I guess they're really in the Navy, although they never really go on any, well, I guess they did a few times do actual war-related kind of missions, but yet they're just underwater. That was about
it.
And yet they run into aliens and things that all talk the same. rock creatures, crab men, all kinds of things, and they all just talk the same.
Well,
y'all had that same voice. It's like,
it was like the
it was just
machines
funny.
On Lost in Space. Because they were like real 60s machines. They would,
right.
Like, you'd turn them on and there'd be like a spiral. So
yeah.
Do the spiral.
And it's like, what's the purpose of that piece?
And here we're in space, but the machinery and things that we find everywhere still have these huge gears with giant teeth.
And yet they did these futuristic functions, but they had this, they're using like industrial revolution equipment here to, like, it's a teleporter. Why does it need all those gears then?
Well, they just didn't have it down. They just haven't had the circuitry right and everything.
Right.
I mean, you look at
just gears together. You can pretty much make whatever you want.
That's right. You put all these gears together. You can make a miniature
machine that can mass produce Dr. Smith.
To Dr. Smith. Or turn people into vegetables. That was a great one. The carrot man.
Yeah.
All these things.
Oh no, we've turned Will Robinson into a carrot. Oh no.
Okay, this is something about space shows, any of them. How do you age in space?
I mean, how do you age?
Okay, if you're traveling in light years and such, how do you age? How are these kids? They always had clothes, too, on Lost in Space. These kids were growing. But they always had clothes.
They had some sort of fabricator in the back that we just, like, slapped on.
The velour fabrication machine.
Let's stop at Kmart on Mars and get some new summer clothes.
No, not Kmart. Kmart,
yeah.
Get some lovely velour fashions.
Right.
And they'll be similar but different.
The
like
center.
The fifth dimension, you know, they would always have similar clothes, but they would be different.
Right.
So the Robinson family has similar clothes,
and
but they're different.
For Dr. Smith.
Well, he packed his own clothes.
I hope so. And then the little monkey they had on there.
Remember? Oh, the poor little monkey.
The little monkey with the with the ears and the head.
Well, Judy had this monkey on there.
No, Penny had the monkey.
Oh, that's right, Penny. The monkey's name was Judy.
No, Judy was the older sister.
Okay.
Oh, no.
That's
monkey,
a monkey of,
Judy
a,
monkey was
that's a monkey
show.
Of another color. By golly. Oh, where was Judy the monkey then? Oh, it's Judy the chimp. Well, I think
that's
it was the same.
Hard.
I think it was the same
well,
monkey,
it probably
though.
Probably was.
And they just put those oh, things
only
on.
Only one
it.
Monkey working.
They just
in the show business at the time.
Here, little monkey.
When can we schedule the monkey?
Let's
for,
see. Let's see. Can we staple this? Let's
right
staple this thing to that monkey's head. Okay, there.
They kind of moved ahead and got Buck Rogers.
Well, Buck Rogers, you gotta if you're going to Buck Rogers, you're in the '70s. There, you gotta go past. Space 1999 and all the different Irwin Allen shows.
Yeah.
No, I mean, not the Irwin Allen. You got to go past the Irwin Allen. You got to get into the Gary Anderson, Gary and Sylvia Anderson, who are doing shows all through the 60s up to the 70s. Because UFO was probably their first real live action, I guess, show. Because before then, they did their puppet tune shows.
Oh, no, those were fun.
You've got Supercar. You've got Fireball XL5,
Fireball,
Stingray, then there's several that didn't get here, Joe 90, Captain Scarlet, and those just never made it over here, I guess, and then you get back here to Thunderbirds, kind of got here.
Thunderbirds are go!
Some were here, some weren't, and then from there you go right into UFO, which used the same, all the same kind of props and things, the same ships and all, but yet it had live, real live people.
Yeah.
And that was just an interesting show because basically UFO, Shadow, the Supreme Headquarters and Alien Defense, well, Supreme Headquarters and Defense Organization, they were out to stop aliens from...
It was good against evil.
Well, all the aliens in UFO were evil.
Yeah.
Because they would come down and they'd mutilate cows and things and they'd find people and they'd cut pieces out of them and put them in little capsules and they'd want to take them back.
Well, they took all the urban folk tales because, I mean, you know, when you're in school you hear, oh yeah, did you hear about the UFO that landed and tore up all the cows?
Mm-hmm.
And then they kind of took those and did UFO with.
Yeah, a lot of that. So, but anyway, you've got Ed Straker, who's the head of Shadow, and he is actually he works at a TV station, but you go under the TV station. And here we've got Shadow's headquarters on Earth. And so from there, you'd take their submarine, and it had the capability, had a ship on the front that could blast off into space, or you could just take a rocket, and you'd fly up to the moon.
Yeah,
and up on the moon is Shadow's real headquarters,
yeah.
The Shadow's moon base.
The really neat vehicles.
Yes.
Okay, like the Thunderbirds we saw sometime this year, whatever it was. And they were real meticulous about their miniatures.
Well, that's Gary and Sylvie Anderson.
Just, you could tell it was, you knew you were looking at a miniature, but it was so well done, and it was so involved. let's take all these Matchbox toys apart and put them back together differently and make something real neat with them.
Mm-hmm.
But were really...
That was really the thing that made these shows, the Gary and Sylvie Anderson shows. It was, they were effects-oriented.
Right.
That was really one of their big things. There's one of the Thunderbird ships. Let me see if I can show
that. Get a shot of that? I don't know. Can we get a shot? Well, we'll get a shot sometime. Oh, we got a long shot.
Woo!
Another explosion!
We'll never see it now! Anyway, well, by golly. So,
I think we're now ready for that exciting still.
Okay.
But of course, we don't have the still now. But
it's still here.
Still here. And this is very exciting for those of you at home.
Okay.
But here we are.
It's a black and white, but it's a still nonetheless. There we go. That's just kind of a camera in there, too.
Oh, here's
but
the UFO.
Let's
pass UFO over. It's got
The satellite that was out in space that kind of relayed stuff between Earth and the Moon, and it was also like their first line of defense against aliens. It could tell when aliens were coming into the solar system. And so you've got Commander Ed Straker, who is the leader of Shadow, Colonel Alec Freeman, who is his second-in-command, Paul Foster, the former test pilot for Shadow, and a lot of other people here. I won't get all into them, but basically...
Well, these are more organization versus organization.
Right.
Exactly.
Everyone had to work together. Team power, go!
And from Shadow Moon Base actually became a part of Moon Base Alpha, which they used in Space 1999. So, it all worked together.
At least Space 1999 was really bland to me. I didn't like it.
Well, they didn't know whether they wanted to be Star Trek or 2001. They were like, we'll do this, we have these things, and lots of gadgets, and it was like, you could tell a lot of it was just like, well, let's see. We could make this into a toy.
it would usually put me to sleep. That's the effect Space 1999 had.
It wasn't all that. It was just kind of like...
Well, you got Martin Landau and Barbara Bain, who had left Mission Impossible in a huff or something, because it's like, when they left Mission Impossible, Leonard Nimoy came in.
Right.
Oh, wasn't that interesting? we'll leave this spy show. We'll go to a science fiction show. He'll leave a science fiction show. Come to a spy show. Well, okay. But Moonbase Alpha, Space 1999, basically you've got the moon here, you've got this base on the moon. Oh, we have a nuclear accident, oh no.
It doesn't blow up the moon, it just creates an enormous rocket-like effect and blows it out of orbit.
It catapults the moon out of orbit. And that's like a Nerwin Allen kind of thing. We'll blow up their whole world and make them put them into a situation. So they fly out into space and meet all these interesting aliens, who all have English accents, by the way. And they look like interesting people, like, Christopher Lee or Brian Blessed or David Prowse made several appearances on there, too. All these people that have gone on to do other great things.
It's like, hello, we're the aliens.
Exactly. We want to take over your world. You have the things that we need. We're going to... we'll capture some of your people and basically blow you up. So it was just an interesting thing there. And then they had the second season of Space 1999, where in which they really did a real interesting thing. They went downstairs and they found new costumes. That's about how they described it, too. We went downstairs and we found these costumes. It's like half of the people went and they took one of a Super Eagle. Eagles were their main sources, their main ships, and they took maybe a few of them and put them all together, and they kind of blasted off to try to find their way back to Earth or something. And the rest of the people are still wandering around here on the moon.
Well, it's much more exciting when you tell the story as the show is.
And then they got an alien that actually joined the crew too, Maya.
Who
was
a shapeshifter kind of person.
Turn into an animal.
Just anything.
Yeah.
Anything, any kind of animal or creature or whatever. To help out, and she had the hots for one of the guys on the moon base there, and Tony,
Tony.
Didn't Tony have the still too? No, it wasn't Tony that had the still. It was another guy that had, or maybe it was. You saw
an explosion in television science fiction in the mid-70s when Star Wars came out, that everybody was cranking out something.
A new space race.
Right. And it was, yeah, in a way, it was, you saw, within the space of a couple of years, you saw Buck Rogers, and you saw Galactica.
Yeah, Battlestar Galactica. Well, Logan's Run, I guess, was out actually a little bit before that, because it didn't have the great technology.
Based on the movie,
And it actually explored the story better than the movie did, but it was still kind of weak.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, because the basic thing that Logan was running from... Well, Planet of the Apes, that's true.
Planet of the Apes took off from, but it was... The show was not... Didn't have the meaning or the spirit that the movies had.
Yeah, because the... You had your good apes and you had your bad apes.
Yeah.
Basically, and that just...
These apes over here that want to dissect you. We've got these apes over here that want to be your friends.
And it's like they had more people in there that were working with the apes, and so it kind of...
Yeah, it just went away from the whole idea
of... It just didn't do well at all.
Well, then, so you had Galactica that...
It was very pretty. Oh, it was wonderfully pretty.
And it probably had the best effects, I would say, of TV.
But of course, once they had the effects, they just said, okay, well, we've got this effect, let's just show it over and over, because you spent a lot of money on this effect. You know, like the fighter coming out of the bay.
Yeah.
That was like a standard shot. It's like, okay, it's time to show all the fighters going out of the bay. Shoo, there's another one. Shoo, and it's like the same footage over and over, because we paid a lot for this.
Maybe we'll show two at a time coming out. Shoo, shoo, woo. Whoa, there we go.
And then there's fighter. No, no.
Well, didn't that part of... Now, I don't know which came first, this or Buck Rogers. But
well, Galactica did come first.
Galactica brought color. Nice color. You know, it was... Where Trek was so bland. It had the great stories, but no color.
Space 1999 was all sterile with white.
With white,
everything
beige,
was white. Yeah.
Gray. They just had a budget for color.
But Galactica did well.
Like somebody forgot to tell them over there at Space 1999. Yeah, they are doing television in color now.
Yeah. I'm being told, believe it or not, we're actually done with the half hour.
Are you serious?
And we have yet to. We barely scratched the surface of this.
Well,
we
this
may have
be
to
a two-parter.
We may have to actually have another part of this show.
Possibly.
Or not. We don't know. We'll see if we can scrape together enough for another half hour. If so, we'll be seeing that next time. And for all of us here at Vast Wasteland, we'll see you later. Oh, no!